The skeleton of the hand is formed of carpal bones, metacarpal bones, and the phalanges. The wrist or carpus is composed of 8 carpal bones arranged in proximal and distal rows of 4. The carpus is concave anteriorly. This curve is converted into a tunnel by a fibrous tissue called the flexor retinaculum. The tunnel will be thus a fibro-osseous tunnel. The flexor retinaculum, in fact, is a thickening of the deep fascia. It holds down the tendons of the long flexor muscles of the forearm, as well as the median nerve, which passes deep to the flexor retinaculum within the crowded carpal tunnel. This is a cross-section of the second row of carpal bones, showing the flexor retinaculum converting the concavity of the carpal bones into a tunnel, and you can see that deep to the tunnel are the long flexor tendons as well as the median nerve. So because the median nerve is located within the crowded carpal tunnel, it is prone to be compressed here. Compression of the median nerve in the carpal tunnel results in carpal tunnel syndrome. Also note in the prosection that the flexor retinaculum is located in the palm of the hand. It is not under your wrist watch strap, as many mistakenly think. From lateral to medial, the 4 carpal bones of the proximal row are the scaphoid, lunate, triquetral or triquetrum, and pisiform. The scaphoid means boat, and it is called so since it is boat-shaped. The scaphoid articulates with the distal end of the radius. It forms part of the wrist joint. At the distal end of the radius, there is a lateral triangular area for articulation with the scaphoid. The scaphoid has a prominent scaphoid tubercle, which is a blunt prominence located to the thumb side of the distal surface. It is palpable. The scaphoid is the largest bone of the proximal row of carpals. Note that it also has a waist. The scaphoid can be palpated in the depth of the anatomical snuff box, distal to the radial styloid process. Note the boundaries of the anatomical snuff box, which are made by the long tendons of the extensor compartment of the forearm. In the floor of the anatomical snuff box, 4 bones are present, from proximal to distal, the styloid process of the radius, scaphoid, trapezium, and the base of the first metacarpal bone. The scaphoid is the most frequently fractured carpal bone. Fracture often results from a fall on the palm when the hand is abducted. Owing to the poor blood supply of the proximal part of the bone, delayed union may take place. Sometimes avascular necrosis of the proximal fragment may result. Avascular necrosis means death due to insufficient blood supply. It affects the proximal part of the bone because the distal part of the bone has a better blood supply. The lunate bone is moon-shaped. As its name indicates, luna means moon. The lunate articulates with the distal end of the radius at the wrist joint. The area for articulation is quadrangular. The lunate is the carpal bone most commonly dislocated. When it dislocates, it is displaced anteriorly. You can see here the displaced lunate and note the shape of the bone. It looks like a moon. The lunate dislocates anteriorly because it is broader anteriorly than posteriorly. The lunate bone is too deep to be felt in the flexor surface. However, it is easily palpable midway between the radial and ulnar styloid processes on the extensor surface. Try this on yourself and note that the lunate rolls prominently under the palpating fingertip during full flexion of the wrist. The third bone of the proximal row is the triquetral. It is pyramidal in shape. Triquetrus means three-cornered. The triquetral articulates with the triangular fibrocartilage or triangular disc that is located at the distal radioulnar joint. The disc is triangular in shape, its base is attached to the radius, and its tip is attached to the styloid process of the ulna. It separates the wrist from the inferior radioulnar joint. The triquetral articulates with the disc, while the scaphoid and lunate articulate with the distal end of the radius. The pisiform is a small P-shaped bone, as its name indicates. It lies on the palmar surface of the triquetral. The pisiform can be felt on the anterior aspect of the medial border of the wrist and can be moved from side to side when the hand is relaxed. Some authorities consider the pisiform as a sesamoid bone in the tendon of flexor carpi ulnaris. The four carpal bones in the distal row are from lateral to medial, trapezium, trapezoid, capitate, and hamate. The trapezium, trapezi, means table, is a four-sided bone. To avoid confusion of the names, remember trapezium is for the thumb. It has a distal articular surface, which is saddle-shaped for the thumb metacarpal, thus forming a saddle variety of synovial joint. The trapezium has a prominent ridge or tubercle with a groove on its medial side, lying on the palmar surface. The tendon of flexor carpi radialis runs in the groove to be attached to the base of the second metacarpal bone. This tendon is separated from other tendons by a deep partition that bridges the groove on the trapezium. Here is the site of the flexor retinaculum, and you can see it here in this sketch, which shows a horizontal section at the level of the distal row of carpal bones. You can see the flexor retinaculum, deep to it is the median nerve, and the long flexor tendons are all crowded in the carpal tunnel. But on the lateral side, you can see that there is a separate compartment that is occupied by the tendon of flexor carpi radialis, which lies in the groove between the ridge of the trapezium and the partition, the fibrous partition here that bridges the groove. The radial artery is related to the dorsal surface of the trapezium on its way from the anatomical snuff box to pass between the two heads of the first dorsal interosseous muscle. The trapezium can be palpated at the base of the anatomical snuff box. The tubercles of the scaphoid and trapezium can be palpated at the base of the medial aspect of the thenar eminence when the hand is extended at the wrist. The trapezoid is a wedge-shaped bone that resembles the trapezium. The capitate, capot means head, has a rounded extremity, a big head, and is the largest bone of the carpus. The hamate, hamulus, meaning a little hook, is named so because it has a distinctive hook. The hook of the hamate extends anteriorly. The hook of the hamate can be palpated on deep pressure over the medial side of the palm, distal to the pisiform. There is a slight groove on the distal surface of the base of the hook of the hamate, where the deep branch of the ulnar nerve makes contact with the bone while arching across the palm within the deep palmar arterial arch. Because the ulnar nerve is so close to the hook of the hamate, the nerve may be injured by fractures of the hook. People who ride long distances on bicycles with their hands in an extended position against the hand grips put pressure on the hook of the hamate, which compresses the ulnar nerve. This type of nerve compression is called handlebar neuropathy and results in sensory loss on the medial side of the hand and weakness of the intrinsic muscles of the hand, which are supplied by the ulnar nerve. Compression of the ulnar nerve may occur at the wrist between the pisiform and the hook of the hamate. The depression between the two bones is converted into a tunnel by a piezohamate ligament. The tunnel is called the ulnar canal or Guyon's tunnel. Thus, ulnar canal syndrome is characterized by hypoesthesia in the medial 1.5 fingers and weakness of the intrinsic muscles of the hand. The carpal bones are shaped to form a curve, as we mentioned earlier. The curve is directed anteriorly. Only those bones at the sides of the curve come near the surface of the palm of the hand, where they can be palpated. These are the pisiform and the hook of the hamate medially, tubercle of the scaphoid, and the trapezium laterally. It is important to consider wrist and palmar creases as landmarks in the surface anatomy of the bones. At the distal skin crease of the wrist, the tubercles of the scaphoid and pisiform are palpable on the lateral and medial sides respectively. The proximal wrist crease is located at the level of the wrist joint. The ridge of trapezium and hook of the hamate lie distal to the scaphoid and pisiform respectively. They are more difficult to palpate since they are covered by the muscles of the thenar and hypothenar eminences. Also note that the heads of the metacarpals lie level with the distal palmar crease. The metacarpal bones form the skeleton of the hand between the carpal bones and phalanges. The metacarpal bones are composed of 5 metacarpal bones, numbered from lateral to medial, 1 to 5. Each metacarpal bone consists of a base, shaft, and head. Thus, it is considered as a long bone in the sense that it has a shaft and distended ends. The proximal bases of the metacarpal bones articulate with the carpal bones. The distal heads articulate with the proximal phalanges and form the knuckles of the hand. The third metacarpal head is the most prominent. Note that the metacarpals, except the first one, are closely bound together, hence isolated fractures tend to be stable. Fracture of the fifth metacarpal bone is often referred to as boxer's fracture. It occurs when an unskilled person punches someone with a closed and abducted fist. In the thumb, a pair of sesamoid bones articulate with the flexor surface of the metacarpal head. In this x-ray, the two are overlapping. That's why we see only one. The sesamoid bone on the radial side lies in the tendon of flexor pollicis brevis, and that on the ulnar side lies in the tendon of adductor pollicis. Sesamoid bones may also be present at other metacarpal heads. The third metacarpal bone is characterized by a styloid process on the lateral side of its base. This styloid process can be felt about 3.5 cm from the dorsal tubercle of the radius. The dorsal tubercle can be felt around the middle of the dorsal aspect of the radius. Each digit or finger has 3 phalanges, except for the thumb. The thumb has 2 phalanges only. Each phalanx is a long bone in the sense that it has a proximal base, a shaft or body, and a head distally. The proximal phalanges are the largest, the middle ones are intermediate in size, and the distal ones are the smallest. The terminal phalanges are flattened and expanded at their distal ends, which underlie the nail beds. Radiographs of the wrist and hand are commonly used to assess skeletal age. For clinical studies, radiographs are compared with a series of standards in a radiographic atlas of skeletal development to determine the skeletal age. Ossification centers usually appear during the first year. Each carpal bone ossifies from one center postnatally. The largest carpal bone, the capitate, ossifies first during the first year, immediately followed by the hamate. This is an x-ray of a 2-year-old child showing the 3 of the carpal bones. 2 of them ossify during the first year. The capitate, the largest one, is the first to ossify. The smallest, the pisiform bone, ossifies last, and this is at the 10th or 11th years. The other carpal bones ossify in sequence according to their size, and the whole carpus, except the pisiform, is ossified by the 7th year. So you can see here, by 7 years of age, we have 7 carpal bones, except the pisiform. In the metacarpals, secondary ossification centers appear postnatally in the heads of the 4 medial metacarpals, but the secondary ossification center appears in the base of the first metacarpal. Secondary ossification centers also appear in the base of the phalanges.